Namaste everybody, welcome to our podcast Clarity in Similarity. Today we have a very special episode, an episode we were all waiting for. And in this episode we are talking about veterinary homeopathy, which is a very special topic because not a lot of people acknowledge this topic and not a lot of people know about it. So to guide us through this journey today, we have Dr. N. Krishna Reddy, and we are very honored and it is our pleasure to have him on the show. Welcome, sir.
Welcome, sir.
So today he is going to guide us through this process of understanding veterinary homeopathy. So we have prepared a few questions that we wanted to ask him, and he very graciously accepted our invitation. Sir, starting today's topic, we would like to know how this field called as veterinary homeopathy came about, and what is its scope? Where do we start?
So thank you for conducting this type of an education and extension program. First of all, let me introduce myself.
Yes.
So my name is Dr. N. Krishna Reddy. So I am graduated from Bangalore Veterinary College, and I did my BVSC, basically allopathic system of medicine in the veterinary field. And I completed my degree, bachelor degree, in 1983. So later on, I joined Karnataka Milk Federation as a veterinary officer. From that time onwards, I was working in the field actually. Basically with farmers and animals, dairy animals.
Right.
So that's how my field experience started.
Right.
And from the beginning itself, I was very much interested in alternate system of medicines.
Right. Yes.
From in my college life itself, my professors of gynecology, Dr. B.L. Pradeep and Dr. Vishnath Reddy.
Right.
So they have started teaching little bit about homeopathy, where some medicines are specifically used for some specific diseases.
Right.
So that's how I picked up using just few medicines in the veterinary field.
Right.
When I entered into the field, basically I worked in Raichur, Ballari and Koppal districts.
Right. Right.
So there, as I was working as a veterinary officer, so I had come in contact with Dr. Ramakrishna Shastri,
yes,
who is basically is a non-qualified but a true lover of homeopathy, and teaching and training the common people about homeopathy.
Yes.
So when I had contact with him in Ballari,
right,
so he started actually teaching to the masses.
Right.
So they started attending the homeo classes there,
right,
and started learning the classical homeopathy there.
Yes. Yes.
And basics of philosophy of homeopathy and the preparation,
right,
and materia medica, repertorization, then the application in the field in the animals.
Right.
So he started guiding me.
Okay.
So it is around say 35 years of journey. Veterinary homeopathy. So then I started using these homeopathic medicines in the field among the animals and started training our veterinarians.
Right.
So that's how it has came into my touch and to the field.
Right.
And basically, see, we have one veterinary, in why veterinary field it is special, because
right,
veterinarian has to go as a holistic approach to treat the animals.
Right.
Because basically animals are herbivorous animals,
right,
purely vegetarian animals. No? They eat just grass and
right,
give milk.
Mm-hmm.
And for those animals, they need natural medicine,
right,
rather than
yes,
artificial medicine.
Yes, yes.
So that is one thing.
Right.
So where we need a holistic approach.
Right.
We know in allopathy, there are some limitations.
Mm.
In case of using antibacterial, it's called antibiotics,
mm,
and steroids. And other all, whatever the anti is there, say they are killers, pain like painkillers,
right,
and steroids, they are very dangerous and have side effects on animals.
Immunosuppressants.
Basically. Yeah, immunosuppressants.
Yes.
So that is why veterinarian needs to have a holistic approach in treatment of animals.
Right.
Basically, along with allopathy, we used to give herbal medicines.
Okay.
Because they are herbivorous.
Yes.
It is an ancient wisdom.
Okay.
These herbal medicines were used to practice. Even
right,
villages also, what we call as Nati Vaidya.
Right, right. Traditional medicine.
Yeah, traditional medicine.
Right.
So traditionally we have that knowledge also we are taught in the colleges.
Right.
And along with allopathic medicines.
So do they teach this in allopathic colleges only?
Yeah.
Okay.
We are taught herbal medicines also.
Right, right. Okay.
So later on, this homeopathy came into the field for 40 years back. So
yes,
40 to 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
In the country itself.
Right.
So that's how it's an entry, it's gained entry into the veterinary field.
Okay.
So as far as veterinarians is concerned, just we had an oath.
Okay.
I would like to just fill this. So being admitted to the profession of veterinary medicine, I solemnly swear to use knowledge and skills for the benefit of the society. Through the protection of the animal health, relief of the animal sufferings, the conservation of livestock resources, promotion of public health and advantage of medical knowledge, and I will practice my profession consciously with dignity and in keeping with the principles of veterinary ethics. Accept a lifelong obligation and continual improvement of my professional knowledge and competence. So here, see, we have to improve our knowledge. As the time comes, age passes, there are many changes in the medical field also. So there is a need for the veterinarians to update his knowledge. What is truly required for the animal health?
Okay.
So in that way, the homeopathy is also one medical science, which since ages, even started from Dr. Hahnemann itself, treating animals simultaneously from humans. Simultaneously started using these medicines on animals also. So that knowledge came from Hahnemann days itself. So homeopathy is not new to the veterinary field, but it is new to the our veterinarians, allopathic system in India.
Even in India, Dr. Sarkar, there is an account of treating the Maharaja of Punjab's horse. Right? Yes.
That's how it started. Yes. And basically, it's called One Health approach now.
Right.
Presently, so even World Health Organization also, is no more as individual systems of medicines.
Right.
We need to have a one health approach, both in veterinary field as well as human field.
Right.
So that concept is gaining more momentum throughout the world. That's called holistic approach and one health approach. One world and one medicine.
Right.
So that is a basic concept. Because animal health is related to public health.
Yes. Yes.
And both are related to the environmental health.
Environment. Right.
So this triangle is animal health is a middle point.
Right. Yes.
So there cannot be a human health without
animal
health. There cannot be animal without environment health.
Right.
So these three needs to be have to be taken care.
Yes.
Any whether veterinary doctor or a medical physician or environmental scientist, they need to focus on one health approach.
Right.
It is gaining movement now worldwide. So coming to the importance of veterinary homeopathy in veterinary field, see, so over the ages, the antibiotics what we use, either in the human field or animal field, they got at this microbes getting gaining the resistance.
Yes.
So that leads to chronic use. So most of the acute is becoming chronic now.
Yes.
So, over so many inventions in the medical field, still the health is very far away from the common man. Why? Because of this antimicrobial resistance. So we need to tackle this AMR. As because these antibiotics are rationally used both in the animals and poultry and sheep and goats and even marine field also. In every field, this and now for agriculture also, now they have started using antibiotics. So the presence of antibiotic residues, not only in milk and meat and eggs, and also in the environment, the water we drink and the food we take. So everywhere these antibiotic residues are there. So that is causing more greater health concerns in the human beings. So unless so, to protect human health out of these hazards, so we need to control the use of these antibiotics among the animals. When you control the use of antibiotics from the animals, what we you can consume more of vegetable foods and animal foods.
Right.
So where we need to control this use of antibiotics in the veterinary field.
Right.
So for which only alternate is either Ayurveda or homeopathy.
Right.
So that's how the need for the homeopathy has came into existence.
Right.
What is the impact of this AMR in the public health? It is more important.
Right.
So growing resistance to antibiotics for the human treatment. So if you go to a doctor, allopathic doctor or a nursing home, they use many antibiotics.
Right.
Because they don't know which antibiotic will work.
Right.
So costliest antibiotics has been used and it is causing more ఒక ఎకనామికల్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ ఫర్ ది కామన్ మ్యాన్. సో దట్స్ వన్ థింగ్. అండ్ అనదర్ థింగ్ ఈస్ దీస్ pathogens gains resistance. So after over a period of time, these pathogens, resistant pathogens, become what we call is call them as superbugs.
Yes.
And they spread nosocomial diseases. From the hospitals, the patients are gaining the infections.
Yes.
And they stay in the environment.
Right.
And they cause resistance, they transfer this resistance genes to other microbes.
Right. Yes.
So this is causing the problems. And another thing is, milk quality is coming down now.
Right.
As per the international health is gaining momentum. We need to produce and sell in the out of the outside market also.
Yes.
And out of countries.
Yes.
So they have restrictions.
Right.
As the public health momentum is gaining, public is also more aware of what is needed for them, healthy food.
Yes.
So like that also, milk and milk products also very prime importance. And this is contributing more GDP to the GDP.
Yes.
25% of the animal husbandry is contributing to the GDP.
Okay.
Out of agriculture and animal husbandry.
Right.
So we can just gain what is the importance of one public health.
Yes.
And another thing is health ministry. They have given guidelines, time frame, amended the rules for rule 97 of the Drugs and Cosmetic Act.
Right.
And what they said, our antibiotics are becoming sick now.
Yes.
Though not only patients,
yes,
antibiotics are becoming sick because they are not active.
Yes.
So that's one problem. So another problem is, World Health also Organization is also giving caution, combat drug resistance. If you do not take action today, no cure tomorrow.
Yes.
That's where we have ended. So with all these cautions, WHO declared that antibiotic resistance is a high priority now in the medical field and serious health issue through its global antimicrobial resistance surveillance systems. They're called GLASS.
Okay.
And launched in 2015.
Right.
So as of 2017 now, 52 countries have there enrolled in the GLIS, this GLASS, antimicrobial resistance. They have contributed for that. So based on the first report, overall, 62-82% resistance is noticed. So WHO thus initiated to create awareness and coordinated between different nations to tackle this AMR issue. And for our surprise, so though so much of research is taking place, for the past 12 years, no single new antibiotics came into the field.
Since 12 years.
Scientists could not produce new antibiotic into the field.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Whereas for most of the antibiotics, resistance is already gained.
Yes.
So doctors are left with few choices of few antibiotics.
Yes.
Mm. So that's a problem, basic problem.
Yes.
So there is need to look into the alternate systems.
Yes.
For treatment.
So moving on from AMR, which is a very interesting topic. Because of this AMR, one of the reasons why homeopathy is not being used by the mainstream medicine is because they claim it to be placebo. If it is placebo, contrary to your experience, how can animals be cured with the placebo effect?
How can they say it is a placebo?
Yes, sir. This is our question. Right.
See, placebo effect is there even without treatment also there, because like a counseling.
Yes.
A patient suffering come to the doctor by the belief on the doctor.
Belief. Yes.
So the way the doctor shows concern to the patient.
Yes.
And how they talk to the patient.
Yes.
Most of it, they get relief, mental relief.
Yes.
That itself is a placebo effect.
Yes.
How mother and child relation.
Yes.
So that's a placebo effect.
Yes.
So, placebo effect need not be through medicine only.
True.
Isn't it? So, because they don't have knowledge of this homeopathy background,
yes,
so they say there is a placebo effect.
Yes,
placebo effect is there. It's all because of faith,
yes,
between doctor and the patient.
Yes. Sir, but in
like a faith of the God.
Yes, but in case of animals, even that is not possible. And it's still
possible.
Homeopathy is what?
Yeah. Because animals doesn't, they have no enmity.
Yes.
There are no existence.
Yes.
Hesitation. There is no question of belief between animal and human doctor, isn't it?
Right.
So that's why there will cannot be any placebo effect on animals.
Yes.
So we need to give medicine. Placebo effect is there on the owner, not on the animal.
Right.
Yes. Yeah. Owner will satisfy giving some medicine.
Yes.
When it is not required also.
Sir, pertaining to the question of remedy selection.
Yeah.
In humans, we have a defined set of remedy selection. How does it differ in animals?
See, basically, human is mentally more elevated person.
Okay.
His mind is more matured.
Right.
Whereas animal mind is premature.
Right.
Except say pet animals.
Right.
Like cats and dogs.
Right.
They are little highly,
more
they have that more emotional and always little bit mentally matured.
Right.
They can understand human feelings.
Right.
But majority of the animals doesn't have that improved or matured mental faculty. It's a very primitive in nature.
Right.
But
in comparison to humans.
Yeah, in selection of the remedy, there are many other parameters.
Right.
Except a few mental symptoms, all other symptoms as we gather from the patient. So, in same way, we also gather the symptoms.
Okay.
And based on totality of the symptoms only, we select the remedy.
So, it is still based on the totality?
Yeah. Totality only.
Okay. In your experience, sir, can you give us some examples as to how certain veterinary hospitals, as you have seen both allopathy and homeopathy being employed, in acute and chronic cases?
Yes. So, usually, as we have worldwide, allopathy is the basic system.
Right.
And 99% they follow allopathy only.
Right.
And farmer also have that mental agonies.
Mm.
Unless they give injections,
it won't.
The animal will not become all right.
Right.
That's the first concept.
Right.
So, majority of the people, they take their animals first to the local available, whether paravets. Say paraveterinarians,
right.
Paramedical staff. If they cannot treat, then they go to a veterinarian, qualified veterinarian.
Right.
Even if they cannot treat treated by the qualified doctors, then they search for some other system, either Ayurveda or homeopathy.
Yes.
So in acute conditions, they just first go to a veterinary doctor or a paraveterinarian.
Right.
In acute conditions.
Right.
Only when it becomes a chronic case. So then only search for other systems. So, patients or owners of the animals going for homeopathy directly, it is almost 90% nil.
No, there isn't much experience.
Not much experience.
Right.
So, even for the cases come to me are only chronic cases.
Right.
So, those known paravets or veterinarian, those who know that I am treating the or homeopathy is there. So, they send to us known veterinarians.
Right.
So, there is a problem. But chronic diseases... But acute diseases, if they homeopathy is used in first day itself, you can cure the man, any sickness.
Right.
But when it comes to the chronic cases, and it takes some time, depends upon the chronicity, age of the disease.
Right. Sir, but it is possible to employ even in acute cases also.
Definitely.
Right.
It's more accurate than.
More accurate.
Yeah.
Since you spoke of AMR being a major issue, how are foods that are being preserved artificially and using a lot of preservatives, how is this affecting health?
See, these animals, there are two types, you know, carnivorous animals and herbivorous animals.
Right.
Carnivorous are dogs and wild animals and these cats.
Right.
Herbivorous animals, major our cattle, milk-producing animals, sheep and goat all.
Right.
So, for them, for herbivorous animals, no preserved food is recommended, nobody will use.
Yes.
That is the one advantage.
Right.
Only when this lifestyle has changed.
Yes.
See, urban people, they maintain these domestic pet animals.
Yes.
So, it has become a fashion for them also to use these preserved foods.
Yes.
What we call is junk foods.
Right.
So, there, these pet animals, which are like hybrids, not like stray dogs.
Yes.
So these pet animals have started getting these lifestyle diseases, what the human beings are getting, like diabetes, kidney problems, cancer, on paralysis, neuro diseases, all this becomes a problem, even these animals also.
Right.
So there's nothing but the effect of these junk foods, preserved foods. Right. Definitely that have an effect on the animal health also.
You spoke a little about the emotions in animals.
However
little it might be, how do we elicit these emotions in animals? How do we find these emotions?
See, though animals doesn't talk.
Right.
Or doesn't have a primitive mind, but they have emotions. Human emotions and animal emotions are almost same.
Right.
Only the problem is the expression.
We do not understand their language.
So, farmers having intimacy with animals, they can understand their emotions.
They can understand.
And animals can also understand the emotions of their owners.
Yes.
So, one thing. And another thing is, they express their emotions through their behavior, nature. And attitude.
Yes.
And their aggressiveness or loneliness.
Right.
And grief also they express.
Right.
So where a veterinarian or owner has to observe these things. Any change in their behavior, change in their attitude, or change in their aggressiveness.
Right.
Has to be understood by the owner. And based on that, if these things are told to the veterinarian, so then it is easy for the doctors to select the medicines and based on that also.
If to vouch for this in our own home, we have 7 cats. So what we have seen is when he enters through the front door, his tone is different. When he enters through the back door, his tone is different. When he wants food, his tone is different. And when he is angry, his tone is different. So I think we can make out.
Yeah, definitely. So let me give some examples.
Yes.
How the mental symptoms are possible remedies. Right. So anxiety.
Right.
So animals will also have anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
So when they look into the new persons,
they
are anxious.
Right.
They transport from one place to other place.
Right.
They have more express more anxiety during transportation
or
during more sound or
during,
more of maximum sounds they don't like.
So at
such situations they will also express, even for natural changes also.
Right.
Suppose climatic changes also they can grasp and express their feelings and excitability.
Right.
And fear of being alone.
Right.
See, some animals if you leave them alone, so they make too much of galata.
Yes. Yes.
Unless some company is there, like a phosphorus patients.
Yes.
Like that, so we use this phosphorus for those animals. And effect of grief. Suppose the loved young ones are died. So they express grief.
Yes.
And some animals doesn't give milk to their kids.
Right. Yes.
So that also, it's all only mental faculty, but expressed as emotions.
Right.
And violent destructive behavior.
Yes.
Sometimes the very docile animal also becomes very aggressive.
Right.
And shows destructive behavior. They may attack the human beings. They may attack the owners themselves.
Right.
So whenever there is change in emotions, so these are some of the mental faculties, they are expressed as emotional symptoms.
A part of our prescription is also based on these.
Yeah, yeah.
Correct. Yes, sir. And why homeopathy is used in veterinary science and what is its advantage? One is AMR, as you obviously said, but are there any other advantages to using homeopathy?
See, one thing is, AMR issue it comes.
Yes.
So where we use more antibiotics.
Right. Right.
For example, in mastitis.
Mm-hmm.
Mastitis is a major 65% of the medicines what we spend on animal health.
Mm-hmm.
It's on mastitis only.
Right.
So what the animals what we use for milking purpose, they are not native animals. They're crossbreed animals. Crossbred animals are more sensitive for the diseases because they have lacks immunity problem. It's an immunity problem.
Okay.
And more of domestication and even hygiene problem. So this mastitis has come to now 30% of the animals are suffering from mastitis.
So crossbred animals have lesser immunity.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's why we are forced to use antibiotics to control this disease.
Okay.
And to treat the disease. There is no 100% cure from antibiotics for this disease.
Yes.
So 65% of the medical cost of the medicines goes to treat this mastitis alone. So it cost nearly 3,000 to 5,000 rupees to treat one case in allopathy. So that's a no. Another is diarrhea.
Right.
Even for simple diarrhea also, from simple diarrhea to infectious diarrhea, paravets or veterans started using antibiotics, like sulfur drugs, tetracyclines, trimethoprim drugs, and now enrofloxacin. Now cipro, most of the antibiotics came into the market with different combinations. So these pharmaceutical companies, they just simply, they produce antibiotics in combination.
Yes.
Take some field studies and push into the market.
Right.
So now any doctors now, not out of their own knowledge, they prescribe medicines. It is the representatives of the pharmaceutical companies. They say this drug works for this disease very well.
Yes.
So they give samples. They take some field studies from their funded sources and they say this is very good, this antibiotic is very good for this disease like that.
This doctor who studied for 5 years?
Yeah, the veterinarians, any doctor, either in the medical field or in the veterinary field. So they tempt, so they are liked by these presentations and they start using these medicines. Over a period of 1 or 2 years, again these medicines become resistant. So again, this pharmaceutical company brings another new medicine in a new combination, a new name.
Right.
So that's how this is becoming a problem.
Right.
And another is infertility problems.
Right.
Almost 25% to 30% as mastitis.
Mm.
Infertility is also a major problem among the crossbreed animals.
Okay.
Because we are breeding these animals through artificial insemination services.
Right.
Not a natural service. So this artificial insemination is also one of the causes to introduce infections and causing infertility.
Mm-hmm.
So there we use antibiotics.
Right.
And there is pyrexia.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Either pyrexia in human beings or animals.
Yes.
They start using antibiotics.
Right.
Irrespective of whether the antibiotic works or not. Even for viral diseases, no antibiotic will work. We know.
Yes.
But still, nobody will take risk.
Yes.
So they started giving antibiotics.
Right.
So like that, and another infectious disease also, we need to use antibiotics.
True.
So that's how these are the major diseases where we push maximum antibiotics into the field.
Right.
So that will cause the residual effect on the producers, like milk and milk products, egg and meat products, and fish, and in the environment. So here, these are the diseases which we have to tackle, and it means where this alternate system, like either homeopathy or Ayurveda, is to be used is, these are the fields.
This is the major advantage. And if even in monetary sense, it is an advantage.
Yeah, advantage.
Yes.
We cannot give for everything to homeopathy.
True.
Allopathy is needed. But
right.
where alternate is needed, this is a priority.
Right. Wonderful. So, again, we have established that homeopathy can be used as a viable system. But what are the present problems that are there in implementing veterinary homeopathy?
Present problem is, so veterinarians trained in allopathic system.
Right.
Mm. Throughout the world, there is only one veterinary homeopathy college in England.
Okay.
Mm. So nowhere in the world.
Okay.
That's the one system. Because doctors are also not aware of this system, new system.
True.
Limiting to modern medical science leads to partial fulfillment of veterinarian's oath.
Right.
This allopathy, it is not a 100% solution.
It's not holistic.
Yeah, not holistic. Right. That's the second problem. And thing is, injustice to the animals and their owners.
Right.
We are literally causing
injustice
because we cannot treat their diseases.
Right.
We produce chronic diseases rather.
Yes. With antibiotics.
Yeah. We say it cannot be cured. We lift hands.
Right now, this is the problem. Let's solve this. Let's think about that later.
That's one limitation.
Yes.
And it's an accepted system is approximately 80 countries.
Okay.
Not throughout the world. Only few countries, even for homeopathic system also, it's not a worldwide recognized system.
Right.
Only few countries gave recognition to homeopathy.
Right.
That's the one limitation.
Right. Now, again, coming back to the same question, sir, we are already done with this.
So, no? Yeah.
Because it's the same question.
Yeah.
Or Should we do this again?
A few inductions.
We will
why in animals it is?
Yes.
Why in animals? Can be easy. Yeah.
Sir, why homeopathy in animals, basically?
Yeah. See, homeopathy is most popular among alternate system of medicines.
Okay.
That's one thing.
Right.
Second thing is veterinarians, the only authorized person to treat the animals.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Others are not allowed.
Right.
And most popular among the alternate system in the animals.
Right.
Ayurveda is a very costly treatment.
Right.
And availability of the fresh medicines is also a problem. But homeopathy medicines doesn't have expiry.
True.
No side effects. And very cost effective.
Yes.
So that's why homeopathy can is a choice. For animal treatment, for a veterinarians now.
Right.
And it's a green medicine in future also.
Yes, yes.
Every year it is gaining around, 20% in a medical field. Homeopathy is gaining around 20% every year.
Right. Okay.
So it's spreading fast among the population worldwide.
Yes.
And other advantage, it is a very safe. No drug residues if you use. No toxicity. No side effects, and it triggers self immune system,
right,
rather than focusing on bacteria or virus. So self immune system is getting improved in the animals also,
right,
and easy to administer also. So giving an injection is a painful thing.
Right. Right.
So owner himself can medicate the animals,
right,
and it is environment friendly.
Yes.
Even wild animals can also be easily administered this medicine. So these are many advantages if you use homeopathy in veterinary field. And there are no restrictions on the species, age and pregnancy. Even pregnancy animals also can be safely, these medicines can be given. And even lactating animals, no side effect, because no side effects. So these are the some of the advantages. In that
subshape. Sir, we had one question here, if you might add. Do they give homeopathic medicines as injections also to animals?
Only few will suggest.
Okay. But generally, it's not there.
Okay. Only few will try as a trial and error.
Right. Because if the
whether you give is injection can be given subcutaneously.
Right. Because if the animal is unconscious and it is not able to chew or digest,
yes,
Do they pull out the tongue and put the drops or do they inject?
Need not be. Just put it on the can take syringe and put it on the. Either it can be medicated,
right,
through bread,
right,
through any meal,
okay,
easily, through water.
Right.
So no. We generally advise to put it on the tongue.
Okay.
If the animal doesn't cooperate, dissolve in the water,
okay,
and just push it into the mouth.
Water and bread are viable vehicles.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Right. Sir, you're talking about
it's total in brief. Okay.
Talking about the totality of symptoms, we spoke about the emotional and mental symptoms. But then, pathological symptoms and the symptoms which are observed, how much of a prescriptive value do they add to the totality?
Definitely. See, among the owner's observations,
right,
you know, mental faculty can be expressed through emotions,
right,
as I told.
Right.
Apart from that, veterinarian physician consider the following symptoms, like local symptoms.
Okay.
It is a visible symptoms.
Yes.
Either we observe or ask from the owner, what are,
right,
the problems, and
right,
general symptoms also there.
Right.
So change in their behavior or production aspect,
right,
based on their age and their productivity or pregnancy status,
right,
and for which purpose the animal is used.
Right.
As we have an occupational aspects, no,
right,
and mental aspects, and specific characters of some of the symptoms also.
Right.
So nature of the discharges.
Right. Hmm.
So like that, we take that. Nature,
right.
So discharge, urine, maybe urine discharge,
hmm,
or nasal discharges,
right,
and color of that.
Hmm.
So all those things we take care.
Right.
And modalities also sometimes they can observe.
Right.
And which time the amelioration is there, which time aggravation is there.
Hmm.
You can also observe like dwindling temperatures.
Right.
For example, like in malaria.
Right.
So morning and evening hours and morning hours, there is a change of temperature.
Right.
And animals also, there are such type of disc called, we call thylariasis.
Right.
Animals.
Hmm.
And babies like that, parasitic infections.
Right.
So we observe the fever, change of fevers, either morning hours, evening hours.
Right.
So based on that also, we select the medicines and give.
Right. Right. Sir, so before we do this question, can we do the next question and come back?
Yeah.
Sir, all our provings, homeopathic medicines, have been proved on healthy human beings.
Yes.
So, do we consider the same symptoms for treating animals, or are there separate provings for animals?
So far there is no provings done in animals.
Right.
So, because homeopathic medicines as done in the medical field, the only heart of the homeopathy is provings.
Right. Yes.
So the provings are there. More importance has been given to the mental symptoms.
Right.
Rather than other general and pathogenic clinical symptoms.
Right.
So in human animals, as we mental faculty is very less.
Right.
Limitations.
Yes.
So medicines cannot be proved, unlike any antibiotics or any human medicines. They are proved on animals.
Yes.
Lab animals.
Right.
Then they bring to the human field.
Right.
But homeopathic medicines are directly proved
humans. Yes.
So not only mental symptoms, even other many types of symptoms are there.
Yes.
So in animals, as mental symptom faculty is very limited, so other symptoms are available for the treatment. So unlike mind change of mind, thinking patterns is not there in animals.
Right.
So that's why provings are not done much in animals.
Right. Sir, but is it essential in the future to do provings on animals?
Maybe if the research is taken,
sir,
that can also be.
Also, the laboratory symptoms, can they be considered for prescription? For example, they have proved some drug, for example, arnica in its crude form on some mice.
Yeah.
Can those symptoms be considered for prescribing homeopathic medicines?
So based on pathological symptoms,
right.
Based on the clinical symptoms,
right.
And based on the diagnostic symptoms.
Yes.
So diagnosis also gives some clues.
Yes.
Based on that, we can treat the animals. That's how now the present status, homeopathy used in veterinary field, based on these symptoms only. Maybe in future, if the research goes on,
Maybe
purely veterinary homeopathy may be developed in future.
Right. Going on to the next question, sir. What are some of the common ailments that you have encountered and some of the common remedies used in veterinary?
See, for example, very common things are like a first aid nature.
Right.
Say injuries.
Yes.
It's very common.
Yes.
So injury, arnica, for using such medicines, not much of mental symptoms are required.
Yes.
Isn't it? For example, arnica is used for injuries.
Right.
Calendula is used.
Right.
Cantharis is used.
Right.
Casticum for burns, cantharis, arctic irons.
Hmm. Right.
These things are used.
Yes.
And for any pains and sprains, Rustax is used.
Right.
For any bleeding, hemamelis.
Right.
And these things, ipecac, these things are used. For any bites, Ledampal is used.
Right.
Insect bites. So like that, most of the first aid nature things can be cured easily with homeopathy.
Right. Are all of these used internally or as an external topic?
Externally, mother tinctures.
Externally, mother.
Yeah. Tinctures. Internally, all dilutions.
Yeah.
And in surgery also.
Mm-hmm.
So very beneficial. Even now, human doctors also started using this homeopathy in case of surgery.
Yes.
Before and after, post and pre-operative surgical complications to avoid, they started using arnica, Hypericum, Staphs agria, and Nuxvomica, and Phosphorus, Megfast to reduce pains, and Symphytamine and arnica, and Ruta in case of fractures.
Right.
So very much useful. We need not think just go for only for mental symptoms.
Right.
And we use in breeding also.
Right.
So there are many drugs like Pulsetilla, Sepia, and Calophyllum. They are specific for gynecological aspects.
Yes.
So such medicines are easily administered used in the animal field.
Right.
And we use in animal welfare also as a preventive.
Okay.
And that's the thing, behavioral controls.
Right.
Because when you transport animal to one place to another place, they are transporting stress.
Yes.
So there, to reduce anxiety, aconite.
Okay.
So such medicines are very much useful in animals.
Right.
And careful handling also. In handling animals also, use these medicines.
Mm-hmm.
So like a little injury for human beings while handling animals.
Yes.
So immediately, Hypericum, Arnica, and this Cantharis is used
right.
In case of such small injuries and trauma. and stress due to handling and transport. Long time these animals are transported, wild animals, the domestic animals, transportation. There also we use this animal, these medicines. And recumbent animals. Animals become recumbent.
Yes.
So, due to maybe injuries, accidents, there also we use these medicines. And say animals from salvage, animals about to die.
Right.
So there also we use these medicines. And to prevent diseases also, we use these homey medicines in veterinary field extensively. For example, according to genus Epidemicus.
Yes.
So many outbreaks are there among the animals itself.
Right.
Like influenza. H1N1, the animal is called swine influenza.
Yes, yes.
And foot and mouth disease.
Yes, avian flu.
Yeah, and lumpy skin diseases. Most of the viral diseases.
Yes.
Whenever outbreaks are there, we use these medicines based on genus Epidemicus. We control the spread of the diseases.
Right.
So most thousands of animals have been protected from these outbreaks
right.
using these medicines precautionary.
Sir, is there any specific potency recommended for animals, or does it again depend on the susceptibility of the animal?
Yeah, potency, when come to the potency point, so as I told you, the mind symptoms are not prominent.
Right.
So most of the animals, diseases can be taken care of with 6 and the low potency, 30 potencies.
Okay.
Only in case of acute diseases or paracute diseases, you go for higher potency like 1M potencies.
In case of acute diseases.
Yeah.
Okay.
Otherwise, medium potency like 200 will take care.
Right. Right. Yes. Speaking about the subject of veterinary homeopathy, is there a course that people can take in order to major in, or is it necessary? Or anybody who will who is practicing on general humans as a homeopathic physician, can they prescribe?
So, when prescription point comes, I think there are restrictions. You know,
right.
The medical ethics.
Yes.
A human doctor is not supposed to treat the animals.
Yes.
Animal doctor is not supposed to treat human beings.
Yes.
Only they can recommend.
Yes. Yes.
When public health point of view comes,
right.
Public health is concerned both for humans and as well as animals and environment, isn't it?
Yes. Yes.
So treatment aspect is only qualified doctors has to be treat.
Right.
Whereas application of the system comes. Not much education is there among the veterinarians.
Right.
Like human homeopathy. Veterinary homeopathy as a curriculum, as a course, or a syllabus is not there.
Right.
So only out in the world itself, only in England.
Okay.
There is exclusively veterinary homeopathy college.
Right.
Called British Veterinary Homeopathy College.
Okay.
So there is a 4.5 years graduation course is there.
Okay.
And post-graduation courses are also there. And certificate courses also they conduct.
Right. Right.
When it comes to India, only those who have learned the homeopathy on their own, in their own interest.
Right.
So some veterinarians started this practicing this homeopathy since 40-50 years.
Right. So there is no specific course.
No specific course.
Right.
Having the basic knowledge of homeopathy, they started this. But in 2015 and 16,
right.
In first of its kind in India, a certificate veterinary homeopathy course started by Kerala Veterinary University.
Right.
It's a 6 months course.
Okay.
The homeopaths, leading homeopaths, they teach veterinarians.
Okay.
Among the five subjects are there. There's a basic philosophy of homeopathy, pharmacology, materia medica, and repertory.
Okay.
And these four subjects taught by qualified homeopathy doctors
right.
from leading universities.
Mm-hmm.
And only a treatment aspect. Application of this homeopathy in the veterinary field.
Right.
Mm. This is taught by senior most veterinary homeopathy doctors.
Okay.
They have rich experience in this field.
Right.
So they start teaching this fifth subject. The field application.
Anybody can do this. Whoever is doing BVSC can do this course.
Yeah, this is allowed only for BVSC doctors.
Okay. Fine. Yes, sir. Since you have spoken about the scope of homeopathy in India, is there any more scope to expanding the field of veterinary homeopathy?
There is a lot of demand from the public itself.
Right.
So not only from learned people, lot of demand from the public itself.
Right.
To give this homeopathy as a medicine.
Okay.
So for which, as a first initiation, it is taken in Kerala. Later on, these learned doctors who have trained in veterinary homeopathy, they have formed a charitable society for holistic veterinary medicine. It is a registered body throughout the India for the first of its kind in Kerala. It started in 2015. And there are many doctors who have trained in this. They become members. Over 300 doctors have been trained so far in the field.
Okay.
And through this charitable society, we have started organizing a training courses.
Right.
So it's a 5 days course, 2 days course like that, and you know, on virtual basis also. So we're training, giving basic knowledge. Those who want to practice. And for better practice, for classical homeopathy practice, we are advising them to become, take this course, register for this course in the Kerala Veterinary. Every year this course is being conducted now. And we are started recommending to other veterinary colleges, universities, to take up this course and their respective states. So and now it is gaining momentum. And we are publishing the public health articles also. Articles and publishing journals and even live cases, so testimonials. Now with the technology enabled distance education program is also started.
In the same university?
Same university. Now we are participating in national scientific workshops also. So there we are taking advantage of this homeopathy among the animals. So that's why it's gaining momentum. This is the definitely homeopathy is the future medical science, both in human beings as well as veterinary. National workshops, all India level, state level programs they're conducting. So these are the pioneers in veterinary homeopathy.
Right.
It's the first batch of trained.
Sir, can you name some of the pioneers now in veterinary homeopathy?
Definitely one, Dr. Madrevar. He was a leading veterinarian from Maharashtra. He is no more. Just recently passed away. But he treated lot of cases, thousands of cases. And he has written 3 books also. He is one of the pioneer in veterinary homeopathy. And then Dr. Ram Kumar Goyal, he is from Rajasthan. Who was a basically BVSC veterinary science in allopathy. Later on he studied homeopathy. That's the one thing. Then started not only treating the animals and started giving so many formulations to treat many type of diseases. He is also no more. And his son is a MD homeopathy. He is running that company. As Goyal Homeopharmaceuticals. So apart from human medicine, they are producing veterinary homeopathy medicines also. Now it is gaining momentum throughout the country. These medicines are being used now. Another, Dr. P.K. Naveen, who is 83 years old from Kerala, who is a pioneer and founder father of this charitable society. The main cause to spread this homeopathy among officially, rather than to taught this PGCUH course also. So he is also presently is practicing, though 83 years old. His name is Dr. P.K. Naveen and Dr. Raman Kutty, Dr. Atman, Dr. M.K. Nair and many others from Kerala. The many veterinarians are treating this veterinary homeopathy now. Another one is Dr. Vishwanath Reddy, is from Bangalore Veterinary College. He was retired as a professor from gynecology department, and since 30-40 years he also started using this veterinary homeopathic medicines. And started teaching students also. And then Dr. Surjit Singh Makkar. He's from Punjab. He is internationally famous veterinary homeopath. He has developed a software also for veterinary homeopathy. Like a repertory, no? Homepath is the vet homepath. Software also is developed.
Sir, in your own personal experience, what are some of the difficult or challenging cases, as they say, that you have faced, and how have you, what was your procedure to it?
So, 2 things I want to put into record.
Yes, sir.
One is foot and mouth disease. It's a viral disease. It is no specific treatment. Even vaccination also, there is no 100 safety is not there.
Right.
For every 6 months, animal has to be vaccinated against this disease. Because
right.
there are many sub-variants are there, mutations are there.
Okay.
So because of these mutations, no permanently, no vaccine is available for this disease. You remember in 2013 and 14, there is a worldwide outbreak of this foot and mouth disease. Worldwide,
right.
and our nationwide also. Because over a period of time, maybe new strains are formed and they become more virulent.
Right.
So there was a practice of vaccinating all the animals every once in 6 months.
Right.
In 13 and 14, because of the election issues and April, May time,
right.
not much animal coverage was there. To get the herd immunity, more than 80% animals are to be vaccinated.
Okay.
But that's previous vaccination schedule. Hardly 60 to 65% was covered.
Okay.
So suddenly this virus become variant, virulent and started producing diseases. Most, in 80% of the cases, there are no deaths. As per the history of the diseases. But for that year, more than 20% animals have died. So at that time, based on this genus epidemicus, we selected medicines like Merixol, Borax, Nitric Acid, Arsenic Malbum, and Calimor. These five medicines we have selected
right.
and started dosing in mass.
Right.
So we could able to prevent outbreaks in lakhs of the animals.
Right.
That is one incident. It has been done in many states also. We took exclusively in Karnataka.
Okay.
So we could save the death of lot of animals.
Right.
That is one incidence. Second thing is mastitis, as I already told you.
Right.
Now most of the veterinarians started using these homeopathy medicines for mastitis.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for chronic mastitis.
Right.
Once it becomes resistant to the antibiotics,
mm-hmm.
then they come to homeopaths. So we are successfully treating, there are thousands of cases are there.
Yes.
So not few cases.
Right.
And accident cases, surgery cases, as I told you,
right.
injury cases. So these are the simple ailments we are treating easily.
Right.
Even for pets also. There are many pet practitioners in Bangalore.
Mm-hmm.
So they are using these homeo medicines for treatment of these minor cases. And especially for infertility also. So three major cases, as I told you, on affirmed outbreaks, disease outbreaks, mastitis and infertility.
Right.
These are three major diseases we are covering in homeopathy.
Sir, does the diagnostic criteria differ in homeopathy case taking as to the normal diagnostic criteria that exists?
See, mostly the diagnosis is based on physicians' observations, veterinarians' observations.
Right.
And questions asked from the information gathered from the owner.
Right.
These are the major two things. Less dependency on clinical aspects. Because taking blood samples or any urine samples or milk samples to the diagnostic laboratory and getting results, it takes a lot of time also.
Right.
It's only time consuming, money involved. Farmer doesn't spend his spare his time to get this diagnosis, and diagnosis facilities available also far away.
Right.
Diagnosis facilities also facilities available to us are limited now.
Right.
So except veterinary college, no other diagnostic laboratory in and around Bangalore.
Right.
So recently we started from KMF. We have one diagnostic laboratory in Devanahalli for our rural district, and one laboratory is there in Chintamani from Kolar Dairy. And four laboratories, one is in Belagam, one is in Gulbarga, one is in Ballari.
Right.
That's all four college, veterinary colleges.
Right.
So in other places, this diagnostic facilities are, so facility availability is very limited.
Right.
So that's why diagnosis aspect is mostly symptomatic.
Right. Yes. Thank you very much for giving us your valuable time for doing and for agreeing to do this, sir. We would like to end this with your advice to the young veterinarians and young homeopaths who need to be instilled with confidence by experienced people like you. So your advice to them?
So my advice is first to the veterinarians.
Right.
While learning coming from the college itself, they should learn this alternate system of medicines. Now teaching is available.
Right.
Online teaching is there. More information is available in the internet.
Right.
So they should gain this access to this information and gain the knowledge and let them register to this course.
Right.
Postgraduate of a veterinary homeopathic certificate course.
Mm-hmm.
So every year Kerala University is offering.
Right.
And apart from learning from course, they should advise the other doctors also, junior doctors,
right,
to practice this.
Right.
And another thing is they should document the cases, successful cases.
Right.
And publish as an articles.
Right.
And there is very good scope to take post-graduation courses,
right,
or PhD courses on this subject, veterinary homeopathy. Because the many scholars are coming out with PG post-graduations and PhDs and many faculties in allopathy. But this is a new faculty.
Right. And more scope
for developing new research.
Right.
So instead of spending so much of money on research, which is only limited to a theoretical aspect, they can take this veterinary homeopathy application on different fields. Focusing on infertility, mastitis, and specific diseases, say genus epidemicus.
Right.
So they can take research on this activity, see, and publish and give better knowledge to the field as well as for the common public health also.
Right.
Another advice for homeopathy doctors in the field. See, our intimacy is there with the animals. So having basic knowledge of homeopathy, from philosophy to veterinary medica, what are the common diseases what we come across among the animals also is known.
Yes.
So better homeopaths can advise.
Yes. They can put it.
Yeah. Yes. Advise treatment of using at least homeopathy medicines for common ailments.
True. Yes.
So yes. That's why awareness can be brought among the public.
Right. Right. Yes, sir.
No, so this is all my simple advice.
I think it has your words will probably instill many people, many homeopaths and young veterinarians to take up homeopathy as a alternative practice in their practice to bring them forward and give them a new perspective in the field as to how to approach health. Mm-hmm. And as you said, it will give a holistic view of medicine. And it is only possible when you inculcate all the medicines. Also herbal medicines, as you said.
Yeah.
And this will only give rise to better health. So we thank you for giving us this enlightenment, sir, and for enlightening us on the very new world of veterinary homeopathy. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And one more addition is Karnataka Milk Federation,
right,
is offering these training courses both in ethno-veterinary medicine, traditional Ayurvedic medicine, mm-hmm, and as well as homeopathic medicine.
Okay.
Training, 5 days training courses.
Okay.
So anybody can enroll their field of interest
mm-hmm,
to try and get the training in this field.
Right.
Another is a transdisciplinary university is there in Yelahanka.
Uh-huh.
It's Ayurvedic college.
Mm-hmm.
There is a exclusively veterinary Ayurveda faculty is there,
right,
to teach and train.
Right.
So there also training programs are going on.
Right.
So those who are interested, they can enroll there also. Online courses are also there, and exclusively practical classes are also there. Classroom classes are also there.
Right.
It's a 6 months course and 1 year course.
Right.
Tamil Nadu Veterinary University is offering 1 year course.
Okay.
In veterinary Ayurveda.
Okay.
And recently Gujarat University also started that.
Right.
So many universities are coming forward to offer these courses.
Right.
So these are those who are interested, they can enroll. Even we too have a branch of charitable society for veterinary homeopathy in Karnataka also registered.
Right.
Among around 60-70 doctors are there.
Okay.
Enrolled.
Mm-hmm.
So those who are interested, they can also enroll their names and get the 5 days training course.
Right. Right.
And we offer 1 or 2 days crash course also.
Right.
A and Karnataka Veterinary Council, they are also giving training to the doctors,
right.
Residential courses.
Okay.
So it is for the veterinarians, field veterinarians,
right.
to come forward and demand for the training programs.
True. And only then the system will grow and we can promote better care. Right. It was very wonderful getting to know you and talking to you, Dr. Krishna Reddy.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for agreeing to do this with us. Hope we can, however small of an effort that we have done, help the society try and better understand homeopathy in this aspect as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Welcome.